Welcome back to the Hank Strange Situation, Lifestyles of the Locked and Loaded.
All right, so you were born here, you were born in Texas, grew up in Texas, you guys didn't travel around or anything?
Yeah, for the most part, born and raised there. That's kind of when I was about 5 years old. That's when that whole stuff happened with my family. My dad went to prison for a drug trafficking crime. Mandatory minimum was there for almost 20 years.
Wow.
And then my mom, single parent, raised four of us. And yeah, so we were there, didn't move much, just stayed really in Carrollton, Texas. That's where I'm from. So, you know, I always act like Carrollton, Texas, like the small town's really not. It's like 150,000 people.
Oh, wow.
Living in a place that's like 2,000 now, and now I understand it's not a small town. But yeah, but the most part, it's pretty quiet suburban area. An Nigerian family, you know how it is, you know. So
yeah.
School was important to me.
Right. It's kind of a weird dynamic. I mean, I remember, I don't know whether or not you talk a lot about what happened with your dad, but I kind of remember growing up in New York in the 80s. First of all, like JFK Airport, every time I went there to like pick up someone that was coming in at the airport, somebody was getting arrested. Usually it was someone getting off Nigerian Airways. There was a yes, I'm not kidding. I'm very serious about this. There was a lot of drugs and stuff like that going on. I even had some Nigerian friends I went to school with. Actually, other African kids were getting involved in that. You know, it was just a big thing. Like, especially in New York, I think the 80s was, remember, the 80s was like the crack 80s.
Right.
You know, so there was a lot of stuff going on there. Did that have like a big impact on the family? Because I saw that you said also your mom at some point wound up going to jail. So was it the same kind of thing?
Yeah, my mom was counted as an accessory, you know. So she was there for a year. And actually, they went to New York. That's where they were in prison. And fun fact, found out later that the reason why my mom left early, but really was given a chance to leave after a year, was then federal judge or then judge or whatever, federal judge, now Supreme Court Justice, Sotomayor, Sonia Sotomayor, she's the one who actually let my mom go and told her she never wanted to see her again and released her early.
Yeah.
So she told me that I got an opportunity to finally tell her in person like a few years ago. And it was interesting to be able to tell like, hey, thanks for letting my mom go, because if not, we would have been essentially orphans. So it's kind of crazy.
Well, so the thing about it, and I've seen you somewhere talking about this, the thing about it is back then, especially in New York, I think it was other places around America, they had some very draconian laws. So for example, one vial of crack, which probably had like a few crack rocks in there, right? Which was not cocaine, it was some baking soda and other things involved in that. Don't ask me how I know about that. Yeah, but one vial of crack actually got you a mandatory 20 years. So
And that was the discrepancy, right? That was the whole cocaine crack discrepancy, where something as small as that for crack, right? Yeah. So it's been interesting to go back and think of like all the laws that were, you know, and that was I will say, people are like, well, it's Reagan too. It's like, okay, Reagan and the Clintons had a lot to do with a lot of those type of, you know, laws.
Politicians always want laws, man. They always want laws, and the people always suffer for the laws, the politicians. I'm not trying to say we don't need laws. I think we need very minimal laws. Like, to me, I think laws should be, we should have like maybe 10 laws. I don't know. We can maybe open up a Bible or something, have 10 laws. Those are all basic, you know, even if you don't, I'm not saying everyone has to believe in God, be a Christian or whatever, right? You know, that's that's your own individual liberty.
What are your 10 laws? I'm interested now. That's
the 10 commandments seems kind of like basic and good to me. I'm not, you know, I don't need to, you know, don't kill anyone. Don't take anyone's stuff. Leave other people's husbands, wives, whatever alone, you know.
Right.
I mean,
right.
It's good. Seems good to me. Yeah. Yeah. So hold on a second. Richie Hughes gave us a couple of bucks here. He says they separated American kids from their parents. Yes. Yes, they did.
Oh, wow. I know.
Yeah.
And I the people who are using that right now being like, yeah, so you guys weren't so, you know, and that's the hypocrisy about it. Mm-hmm. Those same people are the ones who are trying to make it seem like, oh yeah, immigration's like, yeah, I was separated from both my mother and my father for at least a year from my mother and 20 years plus, because my dad now is back in Nigeria when he was released.
Yeah. They barred him from ever living in America again.
Yep. Okay. Yeah. No. So, okay. Yeah. So don't even.
Yeah.
I know.
It's just even. One little side note. He's Nigerian. I know for a fact he can get a totally different name. Did they like fingerprint him? Eye scan him? What did they do? Because, I mean, dude, I know people in Nigeria that could get him a different name. You know what I'm saying?
Right. I don't know. Yeah. I feel like he's living the high life over there. He's changed his name to Chief, High Chief,
That's what kills me about Africa. It's like everyone, you could just buy your chiefdom, you know? I mean, it's like buying a freaking Honda Accord or something, you know?
Why got to be Honda Accord? Well, yeah. Okay, I can see that.
Ghana is really bad with this. Ghana. Lola's from Ghana, my wife.
Oh, okay.
She's Ghanaian, yeah. And Lola, Ghana is really, really horrible with this nonsense. Lots of Americans going over there, paying some money, and then they make them a prince or a chief or a king. Of who knows.
I remember knows being what. A kid and oh my goodness, the amount of times I told people that I was a princess and a dream princess. Oh, so good. It was great.
Too much coming to America.
At our young age.
Yeah. Too much coming to America. Listen, trust me. I know. First of all, I don't want anyone to think I loved the time that I lived in Nigeria. I lived there for, I mean, it was like the formative years of my life, but it was 3 years. I was very young. I loved it. Not so much other people in my family. I think you look at those things very romantically when you're young. And we lived in the northern part of Nigeria, which is Muslim. So if people don't know this, like Nigeria's three tribes, right? You got your Hausa people in the north that they're Muslim. Then you have your Yoruba and Igbo. I'm going to assume you're Yoruba. Or... No?
Why?
No, okay, you're Igbo then? You're Igbo?
Yeah, I'm Igbo, yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I'm just because you meet
you
a lot of
how
your...
We are. Yeah. You know how we are about that.
Yeah. Yes, there's been wars fought over this. Yeah, excuse me. Forgive me for that.
In Dallas, and that's mm-hmm. where I'm sorry, Dallas area, mm-hmm. a lot of the Igbos are in Dallas area. A lot of the Yorubas are Houston.
Oh, okay.
That's just a little bit of... But,
yeah, yeah. For anyone yeah. Who even cares
who really
about this.
Cares about that, yeah. Yeah. Not yeah.
Now,
where we
yeah.
are.
Yeah. So let's now see. We're gonna. This is what I try to tell Lola. Don't. I can't make plans on a conversation like this. So so just going back to what happened with the laws. I think that I was just telling someone today that here in Florida and actually around the country, they're putting in laws like these gun control laws and the bump stock. All of these things are laws that can, that's a lot like the crack laws that we had, right? Mandatory 10 years, $100,000 fine. You're now a felon. I mean, it's just as bad as if you have this one vial of crack, you become a felon, you lose a lot of your rights, not just gun rights. If you owe the government $100,000, anyone who owes the IRS money knows the government doesn't ever forgive any kind of money that you owe them.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go to prison for 10 years.
Right, civil asset forfeiture. So, yeah. I mean, everything. Like, yeah, they're not, and that's, I mean... I know we're going to get into the red flag stuff, but mm-hmm. I mean, that's another thing is that people, if you don't understand the fact that when you give, like literally give the government an inch, they take a mile, mm-hmm. like every time,
yeah,
every single time, you're not getting your right. You're not getting it back.
No,
like you're not giving that power back. So, yeah. Yeah, it is. It's the same type of mentality. It's anti-liberty, we don't trust you. Let's give more power to the government, whether it's drugs or it's firearms or gun rights. Same thing.
So. Yeah. And people, and this is coming from people who are always like on the liberal side, on the Democratic side, right? You have lots of people saying, oh, you know, we want you to be free. But we're going to make these laws, and the people who it's going to affect never really, like, you know, they don't actually stand up for their rights. They support the people. I think this is one of the problems like you have with a lot of black people in America, a lot of immigrants. You see it with Latinos, all kinds of, you know, anyone that comes to America or feels like they're a minority in America automatically votes and supports Democrats. And those are the dudes who want to do everything to put your butt in prison for everything you do.
And that's what they do. I think I always tell the story of how I remember my mom in elementary school saying, like, look, I vote for Bill Clinton. Like, you're gonna vote Democrat. That's what we were doing. Mm-hmm. And then ironically, those, like, the Clintons are the same ones who put those mandatory laws in. And mm-hmm. the reason why my father went to prison, but my mom went to prison for a little bit. Like, that mm-hmm. your elections have consequences. Policies yeah. are important, you know? So, yeah. and they can affect you directly.
Yeah.
Most likely they will.
Yeah, and think about this. Your parents went to prison for something. Now, like today, weed is legal, right? I don't take drugs except the prescription kind, and I hate those myself, to be honest with you. But
the prescription kind is sometimes more
way more destructive. Way more right. destructive. Yeah.
Right.
But the thing is that I don't really think that there's lots of things that should not be illegal, including drugs. People can debate that all they want to, but I think like marijuana, even when you're talking about cocaine and stuff like that, I think people have the right to use these things as long as they don't do it and put other people's lives in danger or endanger children or something like that. Hey, you want to go down this rabbit hole and blow your life away, go ahead and do it. Right now, weed in a lot of places is legal, right? I think probably what happened with your parents was not weed. I'm assuming.
No, it was not weed.
But
no.
Even those things, in the very near future, these guys, the same people right now are pushing to say, let's make all that stuff legal, right? And I'm fine with that. But then think about the people whose lives they just totally ruined over something that now they're like, oh, that should be totally legal.
Right, exactly. And that's the thing is that they flip-flop on this stuff all the time. Like, oh, you know, now it's progressive to be okay for this type of thing, mm-hmm. but it's not okay to be progressive for this type of thing. I mean, right. same thing in the gun, like, the history of gun control and everything. People don't understand, like, the history of – people are talking about rifles now. Well, if you're talking about the 80s and 90s, like, it was – the hot thing was handguns. Everyone mm-hmm. wanted to ban handguns, mm-hmm. right? And then even gun open carry, concealed carry. It used to be a time when it was actually the gun control advocates who were – pro open carry. Why? Because in their like logic, they believe that they wanted to see people who actually had
it. Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, that's the reason why we have so many states that you would think that would be anti-gun states now, like Nevada and in mm-hmm. Colorado. You don't need a permit to have open carry here.
Yeah.
But you do for concealed carry, and that's a whole new thing. But
yeah.
But anyways, that just goes to show that there's no actual. There's no ideology here. There's no intellectual, like, honesty when it comes to it. It's just like, we want – this doesn't seem very good right now. I'm scared, and it is a right for me not to be scared. And so, therefore, I'm going to ban this. It's reactionary. It's not based on good sound policy or ideology or anything mm-hmm. like that.